Nice to have you here. It's our annual Institute of Global Health Innovation special lecture. And on this special occasion, we have a very special man, Sir Michael Barber, who is someone I've known since 2001, 2002. And I'll tell you a little story how I got to meet him. He chaired the delivery unit for the Prime Minister in Downing Street. And I happened to be dealing with the London's modernization agency at the time. And the CEO of the agency was then called John Bacon, had a, if you like, a monthly meeting with Sir Michael at the delivery unit. And these meetings would have been quite stressful meetings because they were all performance managed in those days. So he decided to bring me with him to soften the blow, if you like, get the doctor to come with him. So that was my first meeting. And I remember during the conversation, the hospital stay, or the average hospital stay in London was worse than the rest of the country. And John Bacon was, you know, trying to justify this. And he mentioned the word, one of the reasons, because Londoners have greater comorbidities. And Sir Michael turned around and says, what does that mean? What's comorbidity? And I had my opportunity to come into the debate, and I said, that is when there is more than one thing wrong with you. And he turned around and said, a common problem in NHS management and leadership. So that was my introduction to. And I must say, if you look at the A&E targets, if you look at all the post-NHS plan performance criteria, where they were in those days in contrast to where they are today, it explains to you the contributions he made. He was also the former chief advisor on school standards, where he focused on school improvements and educational reform, funding for higher education, and also access to schools in lower and middle-income countries. After he joined the delivery unit, the Prime Minister's delivery unit, and that's in Tony Blair's era, he left, I think, in 2005. And then following that, he was the founder and the chairman of the advisory firm Delivery Associates, who worked essentially across the globe, helping governments and the public sector there in really implementation of any educational or health reform or whatever reform structure they were introducing. In recent times, and we're going to hear about this later, over the past 10 years, he's been helping the British government in reform in Punjab and Pakistan, and he's been there more than 50 times to accelerate the delivery of better outcomes in education and health systems, and I'm really looking forward to that. So please show your appreciation to Sir Michael. And Michael, I'm very, very grateful for doing this, and I'm sure it's going to be an insightful lecture to all our students, and having the Provost here and also the Vice Provost here. So thank you very much for being here. Thank you. Please welcome.
Well, thank you, Ara. It was always a pleasure working with you back then, and I've forgotten that incident, probably rightly. Anyway, it's a real pleasure to be here. It's the third time I've been to Imperial in the last year and a half. It's a fantastic institution. Those of you who are students here, I'm sure you know that, but it's always a pleasure to come here, and the sense of being at the forefront of science and medicine and health really comes through when you come here. So thank you again for the invitation and the opportunity. I also just want to say one other thing by way of introduction before I get into you'll see some stuff in the slides in a minute, but I actually want to talk about something else before. I guess that quite a few of you are familiar with the Old Testament, one way or another, and if you're not, you might be familiar with the Quran, and if you're not, you might be familiar with rock operas, but I'm going to tell you the story of Joseph, but probably not as you've heard it before. So Joseph, you know this story. So, you know, the Pharaoh wakes up and he's had a dream. And the dream, you know, it's seven fat cows passing in front of him and then seven thin cows. surrounded, because this is what happens with pharaohs, he's surrounded by the court. All the courtiers are there, because you don't sleep alone if you're a pharaoh. And he looks out across and he says, I've had this dream. And he tells them the dream, what does it mean? And they're all terrified, because pharaohs are terrified. And they're all sort of hiding. None of them wants to risk getting wrong the interpretation of this dream. So they're long silence. He said, I've had this dream, what does it mean? Eventually they wake up, so they recognize that somebody's got to answer the pharaoh, because otherwise they're all going to be in trouble. So this guy says, well, we're not very good at dreams, pharaoh, but I just want to tell you, there's this guy in prison who's brilliant at dreams. And the pharaoh says, bring him. And they send the soldiers, and the soldiers come back. It's all in the Old Testament. This is pretty much verbatim. They drag him from the cell and they throw him across the marble floor, and he finishes up right in front of the pharaoh. And the pharaoh says, I just dream, what does it mean? Joseph says, I know exactly what that dream means, pharaoh. It's in the Quran as well as the Bible. He says, you're going to have 7 years of plenty, the corn will grow, the sun will shine, the Nile will flow, the irrigation system will be fantastic. The people of Egypt will eat well. And then you're going to have 7 years of famine, and the corn won't grow, and there'll be hardly any grains on the few blades of corn that do grow. There won't be enough water in the Nile, the irrigation system will dry up, the sun will be too hot, the people of Egypt will starve. Now, Joseph's done pretty well, now much better than the courtiers, but he doesn't stop there. He's only 30 years old, but he says, so what you've got to do, Pharaoh, is you've got to save the corn for the first 7 years. You've got to save 20% of corn every year for 7 years and store it, and then when the famine comes, you'll be able to feed the people. And Pharaoh is listening to this guy who few minutes ago I was in prison, and he says, Joseph, that is brilliant, and because it's so brilliant, I'm going to put you in charge of saving the corn for the next 7 years. Forget this lot, you're going to do it. And by the way, this is exactly in the Bible. He says, don't hang around in the court, because I've got enough people hanging around here. Look, I want you to get out there, and because I want you to get out there, I'm going to lend you my second best chariot. I'm keeping my best chariot for the pharaoh, but you can have my second best chariot. Get out there and start saving the corn. He said, put somebody in charge of each region. Put somebody in charge of each locality. Build a barn in every district in Egypt and start saving the corn. Now, off you go. And off he goes. And he builds the barns, and he appoints people in every region of Egypt and then in every district, and the barns get built and the corn grows. And he's got to save 20% of the corn every year, and he checks, he counts the corn, and then it says in the Bible, after 3 years there was so much corn it was without number. You didn't need to count anymore. When we were doing health waiting times, we used to call that ahead of trajectory. So the corn is saved, and then the famine comes, and you know what happens, the corn doesn't grow, but they've got bulging barns in every corner of Egypt. And there was no welfare dependency in Egypt. They sell this corn crop to people at subsidized prices, and everybody can eat. But the famine extends far beyond Egypt. So people start coming to Egypt, because they hear the corn is there, and Egypt sells corn, and it solves its balance of payments problem, just like that. And eventually, as you know, brothers who betrayed Joseph decades earlier, brutally, end up coming to see Joseph. They don't know that this is their brother. And he says, I'll get you some corn if you go back and get your father. And they bring Jacob. And there's a wonderful family redemption. The story in the Quran and the Bible is all about family redemption and forgiveness and all of that. But I'm telling you this as a story of delivery. So let's go back to the beginning. The dream. We have a name for that kind of dream in modern Britain. We call it a treasury forecast. 7 years of plenty, 7 years of famine, 15-year forecast. The pharaoh completely gets it. This is a problem. Forecast is worrying. I'm not going to say an end to movement lost, I'm going to think that for 7 years, I'm going to think over a 15-year cycle. And he also understands that he, the Pharaoh, while a man of many talents, isn't kind of guided in sorts. Primarily needs Joseph to live for him because he's got a lot of layabouts in the court who demand time and fill the posts, but they don't actually do anything. So he appoints somebody in charge of delivery, and he says to Joseph, go and do it. And he says, Joseph, build somebody who is the Pharaoh and Joseph, and then I want somebody in every region, and somebody in every district, and somebody to build every barn. We call that in delivery a delivery chain. You've got to make sure it works at every level. So we've got a trajectory, 20% above baseline every year for 7 years. We've got a delivery chain. We've got Pharaoh, we've got a delivery unit, and we've got a treasury forecast. But why am I telling you this? Because we've known how to do this for thousands of years. The question is, why don't we do it more often? If they could do it then, why is it so difficult to do it now? So you come to the SDGs, the Sustainable Development Goals. 2015, the world had sort of made progress with the Millennium Development Goals, definitely made progress, not met them all, but made progress. So it sets goals for 15 years in 2015 for 2030, almost exactly the same length of time as the Pharaoh has in his treasury forecast in his dream. And 5 years have passed since those goals were set, and I started looking at them in relation to, this is the School of Public Health here, and I do work for the School of Public Health at Harvard, and I was thinking, well, how are we doing on the health goals? And I've got a few slides, but they're not the be-all and end-all of this. But there's 17 of these goals. They were set for 15 years. I've summarised them, obviously, in this detail, and they're pretty ambitious. No poverty by 2030. That'd be fantastic, wouldn't it? But it's not easy. Zero hunger. Zero hunger. Good health and well-being for everybody. Clean water and sanitation for everybody. I've been working for the last few years in Canada with the Trudeau government. Until recently, they haven't got clean drinking water to every indigenous community in Canada, one of the most crowded countries in the world. So we want to do that for everybody. We'll come to that in Punjab in a minute. And then the others, I haven't listed them all, but climate action is one of them. I've given that's been a great discussion in the last couple of days. Really important. There's a biodiversity one, there's an education one, and so on and so on. 17 really ambitious goals. You can quibble about details, but actually, if we achieve these 17 things, it would be absolutely fantastic. I want to know where the Pharaoh is, where the Joseph is, where the trajectory is, where the implementation technology to make that happen is. Because 5 years have already passed. Joseph started that day. You're only 30, but get out there. Here's my second best charity. Who's getting out there to do this? That's what I want to. When I'm talking to a government, if I'm talking to Prime Minister, Minister, these are the five questions, right? I've never met a minister before. So what are you trying to do? What actually are you trying to do? I know it's nice being a minister, having a car, and all of those things, but what are you actually trying to do? And they, if you push them, most ministers can come up with some priorities, and then you say, well, okay, well, that's a priority, but how do you know you've achieved it? What's the measure, what's the way of measuring that you've achieved your priority? So, very specific. On the SDGs, we are quite good at that. There's 17 of them, and they each, in the detail behind what I just showed you, there are measurable goals. It's good. They've done well. You know, the UN and governments have done well on that. So they've answered question one. That we're going to do these 17 things, we're going to do them by 2030. Here's how we'll know. You can argue about some of the data systems and all that, but the details there. Come to question two. How are you going to do it? Well, we're going to publish them, and then we're going to have governments kind of sign up. We'll come to the challenge. How do you know if you're on track? And there is a website where you can track progress towards the SDGs, and it's at the moment it's not terribly encouraging, but it's something to go. And what are the monitoring routines? How do you make sure, month by month, quarter by quarter, year by year, that we're making progress to 17 goals? Whose job is that? How would we know? That's what Harold was describing in the introduction, a stock take. We're reviewing, are we making progress towards those goals, in that case in London? Because if we're not making progress, it's not that we want to yell at anybody, we just want to make sure the problem gets solved. But this question of routines in a government, in a world and a government where lots of governments are facing crises, building the routines into a government works is really important. somebody somewhere in the government needs to be saying, well, you're trying to do these things, can we help? And that's what the delivery unit did for Blair. That's what the delivery, the results of the delivery unit does for Justin Trudeau in Canada and so on. So you need a core of this, which is like Joseph in ancient Egypt, that is doing this. And it's making sure that the leader doesn't get distracted, because leaders get easily distracted. So if you can keep focused, whatever you're doing, doing it requires a lot of discipline, and at the moment on the SDGs, it's questionable whether it's happening. I want to give you an example from Pakistan, where I've been, as Aaron mentioned, 50 odd times over the last 10 years to try to improve education and health. And I'm going to race through lots of slides just to give you an example. And the reason I'm giving you an example about Punjab is obviously the big part of my life, and we made some progress, but we didn't solve all the problems. There are lots of challenges, there are still lots of challenges. Because if that's what it took in Punjab, Pakistan, and we're trying to do these 17 things across the world, and it's not even at first base in some parts of the world, how are we going to get this job done in the 10 years we've got left? There's Pakistan. It's about 200 million people. Half of them live in Punjab, which is basically this chunk here. So 110 million people, about 35 million children in Punjab. When we started, this is 2010 roughly, 40% of the children are out of school, 20% of the teachers didn't turn up on an average day, and more than half of third graders couldn't read a sentence in Urdu, which is the national language. That is why we call it a crisis. That's a big set of problems. I think we need more data. So what do we do? So the chief minister at that time was called Shahbaz Sharif. When you go back to the history of Pakistani politicians, very few of them are perfect. But Shahbaz is a determined and driven man who desperately wants to improve education, real passionate driver. So we set some goals. I won't go through all of them, you can see them there. Anybody who wants any of these slides, feel free. The computer approach can shoot them if you want them. That's it. If you're taking notes for your students and you've got essays to write, like Joseph, we wanted to get data from school. How to get data from 55,000 primary schools across Punjab, 55,000. We designed a data system with 900 guys like this, 900 ex-army guys. The only technology involved was we gave them a motorbike and a tablet. And they on Monday, they show up to work somewhere in Punjab, and they get given 15 schools to visit that week. They never know before that Monday morning which 15 schools are to be able to build proper relationships. They'll never go to any of those schools again for at least 6 months, maybe a year. And they get on their motorbike and they go to the schools and they go into the school and they count the children. They don't check the register, they count the children, they count the teachers. They check that the water runs in the tap, they turn the electricity on to see if it works. They check the boundary wall, the girls' toilets, the boys' toilets, all the rest of it. And then they report back. So 900 guys, 15 schools a week. Trust me, that gets you to about 55,000 schools in a month. And then the data, once they put it into their tablet, it just goes straight into our computer in the hall. So by the end of February, you know all that stuff for all 55,000 schools. Of course, the schools think sometimes, well, once the guy's been, he won't come again, so we can stop turning up. So then you have a random set of motorcycles, so you go twice or three times to the school. But we don't actually know. So that's what they're doing. And then that data is now in our computer, and 2 weeks later it's in every school, so every head teacher knows how his or her school compares to every other school in Punjab. And that enables you to do really fast data. This is a slightly difficult slide here, but the other thing we had to do was fix some basic things about how government works. This has nothing to do with education, it's just inefficient government. It was very common for there to be a turnover all the time in all the key positions. Like four secretaries of education in a year was very normal. I met the new minister for education in Punjab on Tuesday. He told me he had nine secretaries merit-based appointments instead of political positions, getting the data working, dealing with corrupt practices when you found them, building the capability, training the district leaders in Punjab to actually do this stuff, the people who built the barns and all the rest of it for the pharaoh, and rebuilding the school building in Venice. So some basic stuff is happening all the time. And every 2 months, as the chief minister down there, we review progress in a kind of brutally honest conversation. And the chief minister should be pretty brutal. I remember him once saying to his secretary, "I want the head of that district suspended." And the secretary said, "Well, chief minister, he's already suspended." And the chief minister said, "Well, throw him in the Arabian Sea." So this was a big, vigorous back and forth, but people got used to it because the passion of the man was so committed to doing, to getting this right. And you see, we self-imagine the system. So how many spills were visited in a given month by a district official? When we started, one school in five got a visit. By the end, every school got a visit every month, pretty much. So just basic management was put in place. And then these things happen. I'll just whiz through some statements. I just want to show you, though, that the data doesn't just tell you whether you're doing it in Punjab. It tells you district by district. It shows you where the problems are. You can see on enrollment south of Punjab, it's got a huge challenge. There's no point in yelling at these people, or the chief minister did sometime. You've actually got to solve the problem of the tribal areas down by the Indus River, where it's really challenging. We did make progress, but the data enables you to pinpoint your target. You don't have to do blanket policy for the whole Punjab. You can do a special policy for the southwest corner. And we use these slides every 2 months with the chief minister to show him where the problems are, and then you can dig down into the individual areas exactly as the pharaoh was asking Joseph to do. And so you get 1.5 million children to school within a couple of years. These are people who enroll but now showing up. The teachers, 37,000 extra teachers showing up every day. And 3 million children in better facilities. So that's just from basic management. But then if you want the school system to be good, it's not enough to just to enroll people. You have to make sure that they learn something. India did a fantastic job of enrolling kids all the way across India. But if you look at the learning outcomes, as the enrollments went up, the learning outcomes went down. We didn't want to make that mistake because we were learning from what they'd done across the border. Punjab in India, which had the chief minister of Punjab makes examples about East Punjab. So at the same time we struggled with this for like two, three years to get this right. So there are six things you have to do. You're mainly health audit, so I had to spend a lot of time on this. But to get learning outcomes to go right, you have to streamline the curriculum. What are the things you really need to make sure children 8, 6, 7, 8, 9 actually need to learn? Not just a huge mass of stuff. Rewrite the textbooks with the right stuff in. Rewrite the teaching guides to help them use the textbooks. Train the teachers to use the teacher guides to use the textbooks to teach the stuff, and then monitor and manage that they're actually doing that, and then assess the children regularly to show that they've learned the stuff. And you have to do that as an integrated whole. Whereas what happened often before was you did one bit of the curriculum but not the assessment, or you did the teacher training but not the curriculum, not this. So these six things in a continuous improvement cycle. And the learning outcomes improved. And for those guys on motorbikes, once we've done this, in addition to counting the children, we gave them on their tablets hundreds or thousands of questions, like, what's 5 times 7? And you know, so they walk into class and ask around the third children these questions or early sentence. And so it's literacy and numeracy, it's LMD, that's what that stands for. So we get random question answers, and this is the improvement percentage. Nobody thinks this is a really good systematic way of measuring learning outcomes, but did put it on the agenda for everybody. And then we had a random sample property controlled every 6 months test that checked whether this was really happening across the province. on that, the chief minister said, well, hang on a minute, if this works for education, why can't we do health and waste first? So we spent a bit of time on health. I'm going to make sure there's at least 35 minutes for questions, so don't panic. So we've done the education roadmap, then we introduced it to health 4 years later. So we did the same thing. EVACs was a wonderful thing. EVACs was, so vaccinated were a bit like the teachers, a lot of them were being paid to vaccinate, but didn't vaccinate. We give them all a tablet. When they vaccinate a child, they take a photograph of the child, but the photograph goes into the computer and or it's geotagged, so we know which children have been vaccinated and where, and we have a map. So you can start mapping it at a very local level, where the children are, and then you have a call centre in Lahore, because when you're doing the vaccination, sometimes the mother will give you the mobile phone number, and the call centre will check that the mother is happy with the service and the child really was vaccinated, and you've got a picture of what's going on. And you get this massive increase in just over a year of vaccinated tractility from 46,000 vaccinations in January 2015 to three times that, simply by a bit of discipline, a bit of data, and the application of technology. And again, you get the same local ability to track it down, actually to individual villages below districts. The chief minister loved these graphs, these maps. When we gave them the first time, I said, I'm going to sleep with these other time pillow. and then, these are just more the data is endless. And Gavi, an international organisation, I'm sure Aaron knows very well, said that this was a model for other provinces and countries, and one of the fastest scale-ups of vaccination to herd level, herd immunity level in history. And then we do it with solid waste management. I won't go through this, but there's a lot of this horrible in that relation to the SDGs. Checking the works actually showed up with all kinds of things we did, but we tracked the waste trucks. We put geotags on all the waste trucks so then you can see where they all are. When we first got them to sharp, they did sharp, and then they drive the truck around the block and put it back. But once you've got the geotag, you can see where the truck's gone. Waste collection went up. Then we took it to rural Punjab. So we took 3.5 million pictures of villages. So we said to the villages, we're going to do a one-time clear-up. And we took before and after photos. And this is on the website somewhere if you want to check it out. But we made lots of pictures, 3.5 million. This is just one small village in Punjab. So what am I saying here, summarizing this? This is what government is often like. I call it government by spasm. You don't know what your priorities are, you're pretty vague, you're managing crises, you're guessing, etc., 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 you're making announcements and you love sound bites, but you don't get anything done. And this is what we're trying to get to. Clear priorities, specifying success, building in these things, building the routine. It's boring. Routine government is boring, but you've just got to do it if you're going to achieve these big goals. So the SDGs, I've just given that example because that's one province of one country, 110 million people. That's the effort involved in getting close to meeting the SDGs, or the predecessors, the MDGs for 2015, and on track for these things. But that's a big effort, and it's not guaranteed because it could all slide away depending on what the new government does it in Punjab. So these are questions. Where's the leadership and sustained focus for those 17 goals? Where's the coordination? What if you met the zero hunger goal by eliminating biodiversity in large quantities? You could make real progress by certain types of agriculture that would be devastating for biodiversity, so one target would be in conflict with another. Where are the operational plans for doing this? Some countries have some of them, but many of them don't. The data and routines for checking we talked about earlier. The basic government functioning, dealing with corruption, incompetence, untrained people, political appointees who don't really know what they're doing, people who don't show up to work. This is basic stuff that you've got to solve in large parts of sub-Saharan Africa, parts of South Asia. And then there's a question about value for money. So I'm going to finish on a couple other things. Because you could do the SDGs, it's still possible to do that. And we should set out to do it, but we need stable, effective states that can do this kind of thing. And we need the political thing that can do the job and a leader who says, yeah, we are actually going to do this. You don't have the ambition to do it and the ability to do that. But then I look around the world, and you can let me know if I've got this wrong, I see quite a lot of stable, effective states without the political will to do this. I didn't hear a strong commitment yesterday from the President of the United States, for example, to one of the 17 SDGs. Then there are lots of unstable, ineffective states with variable political will. And then there are some states that are really troubled by conflict and fragility with large numbers of people. David Miliband made a speech at ARA's conference in Qatar recently. It's called WISH.
World Innovation Summit.
World Innovation Summit Health, yeah. And here are some figures that David Miliband gave. So there are 27 on this, the IRC, the International Rescue Committee, if they count the 27 fragile countries in the world, but their population is hundreds of millions if you add it up. Only four of those countries are currently on track to meet the end hunger goal. So there's 23 that aren't. And this is just the fragile countries. And then, if you look at the IRC figures, 68 million people displaced, 135 million are getting humanitarian aid, and 70% of all the under five deaths are in fragile and conflict affected countries. So just that lot, that's a really tough set of things to do, to sort out in 10 years. Imagine trying to get that done in 10 years, just then. But that wouldn't be enough to meet the Millennium Development Goals. And at the moment, they're not remotely on track to meet the sustainable development goals. I'm going to cut a couple of slides and finish. The clock is ticking in the room, and I thought I'd finish after 35 minutes, which is right now. I counted the number of days between now and when these goals are meant to be met. I counted to the end of 2030. I'll be able to check my maths. That's not very many days to solve some very big problems. And if I go back and reflect on the 10 years of working with those people in Punjab, that was an awesome experience. It was very demanding, and some of the people worked really hard. And even with all that progress, it wouldn't necessarily be enough to get this lot done in 10 years. So the question for all of us, whether you're in school of public health at a great university, or you're in politics, or whatever you do, is how do we get people to understand what it will take to make these sustainable development goals actually achieved over a 10-year period? It can't be out of reach if they could do it in ancient Egypt and do it in modern Punjab, but it's not easy, and it won't be possible if we leave it to 2035 and say, oh, hang on a minute, we've got those goals to meet in 5 years' time, we've got to get on with it, by the way. Thank you very much for your time. Thank you.
So my name's Nick Jennings, and I'm the Vice Provost for Research and Enterprise here at Imperial College. And I have the pleasure of overseeing and looking after our Global Challenge Institutes, of which the Institute for Global Health Innovation is one of those. So that's kind of why I'm standing here. I have the pleasure of conducting the question and answer session. I think you've left us with many questions that I'm sure you would all like to discuss with us. So that's what we're going to do for the next 20 or so minutes. So does anyone want to start our questioning? Thank you.
That was a very eloquent talk, and I very much enjoyed it. I particularly liked the bit that you talked about that methodology in education, where you did the little kind of sampling and then followed up with a more extensive program. And I think actually you could do it in a very eloquent way. What you've done is an adaptive Bayesian trial. So in modern trial kind of terminology, that would be very, very, very powerful. There's a lot of data that you get from that program, but you have to kind of convince that to policymakers to kind of convince that this is something very real and we need to do something about it. What metrics do you think are particularly powerful that make politicians, you know, look up to you and say this is what I need to change?
Yeah, it's a very nice question. And and by the way, for questions, although this is a beautiful and polite question, you don't have to be polite.
I should have mentioned that you're happy to have impolite questions as well.
Politeness is very nice, but don't feel obliged. But this is good. And the what I found with the first of all, obviously in health, lot of experience, and rightly, of randomized controlled trials, and they take time before you get a result. That's inevitable. So they should happen, and the data should be used. But quite often, for management purposes, you need more time. You need data on much more rapid sites. Like, that's why we have the 900 guys on the motorbikes. We did the same in the motorbikes in Cabo Action Park, where we had women go to the girls' schools, because that was the culture, and they couldn't go on motorbikes, and they could get their own cars, and they we were worried about their security, and they said, just give us guns, we'll look after ourselves. It's a low-tech approach, but the speed of data and the speed of the analysis of data, to get politicians on board, you have to get them excited. When you get data like we were getting, it's not perfect. You know it's not perfect. You know it's good enough, and you check it against other things that tell you, are we roughly in the right direction? The key for getting politicians on board, which is your question, is you have to show them the data regularly. You have to simplify it, so it's really clear. Those maps are really beautiful. And if you're the Chief Minister, you can understand it immediately. The best graph we ever did for the Chief Minister on anything, was when we started on the health roadmap, and we had infant mortality data from Punjab, Pakistan, compared to Punjab, India, compared to Sri Lanka. Three bars, very, very simple. Punjab, Pakistan's infant mortality rate was 84 per whatever it is, thousands, and Punjab, India's was 37, so it's less than half, and Sri Lanka's was 5. And the Chief Minister looks at that graph, and he's got all his health officials sitting there, and he goes, he said, how can you sleep at night? You've got to simplify it without losing integrity. And then you knew that when he said that to his health officials, he was going to get onto it. And whenever they get that data again, it will be much, much better. But whether it's caught up there, I don't know. But it's as much about the collection, the speed of the analysis, the routine use of it, and then the clarity of presentation. These are the things that make the difference.
Thank you. Stephen?
So I do think that's a good point. First of all, there is no substitute for political will. So if you find a country where the leadership isn't that bothered, you can't do without political will. So then you can go and look for it. Maybe you can find it in a given province. So you can go to some countries where the national government doesn't really mind. But if you get a couple of provinces doing it, then you publish data comparing the provinces, and then it can take off. So you always have to find a political will somewhere in the system, and if there's none of it, the truth is, whatever you try and do, aid agencies struggle with this. They find an NGO that might do some nice little niche project, and that's not a bad thing, but it doesn't change move the big numbers. But I do think international comparisons, benchmarking, transparency is really powerful, and if you can present that data well. Celebrate the successes as well as the challenges. And then somebody has to say, because the first reaction sometimes to that kind of data is to say, well, look how difficult it is to do whatever it is in this country. We've got a war. And that's all true. But somebody has to say, look, we're going to change that now. That we're going to face the facts, and we're going to make some progress. Conflict resolution. Basically, there are three, nearly every problem in the world comes down to three things: resolving conflict, building a state that works, and then finding political will to use the state to rule the goals. If you can do those three things, you can solve all these problems. Mm. But transparency is a key part.
You mentioned the need to specify.
Do you want to speak
pick up slightly.
You mentioned the importance of specifying success. And when it comes to setting goals, how important is it to be ambitious, or how important is it for those goals to be achievable?
This is a classic dilemma. And I'm in favour of being ambitious, so I would push people to the limits of ambition. And I'd never say ambitious but achievable, I say ambitious and achievable. And the idea is that you can be in a comfortable state doing well, the economy's growing, and you're. I remember in 2002 going to Victoria in Australia, the economy's growing, they haven't had a year's recession in Australia for 20 something years. And Victoria, the government of Victoria, published a thing called Growing Victoria Together, and they have a lot of very modest goals, all quite nice. And they were saying, well, we're under promising and we're going to over deliver, and that's fine. And in a comfortable place like with Melbourne, for all the good things that Australia has, maybe that's the right thing to do. But to meet these goals, you've got to be ambitious. So you need the ambition. And that means building in understanding that being ambitious and falling just short is a huge achievement. So then you say, well, if we're going to be, how do you know whether the ambition is completely unrealistic? So you can do benchmarking. So we did this with hospitals in England. So you look at, when we're setting the waiting times targets, you look at the 200 hospitals that have A&E departments, and you see that a handful of them are already pretty much achieving the 4-hour wait. So if they can do it now, and you check obviously for social factors, why can't everybody do it? But you can ask a set of questions. Do you want the whole country to be as good as the top 50%? Would you like the whole country to be as good as the top 10%? And so on. And there is a kind of science of ambition. But the big thing about ambitious goals is you probably don't know enough at the beginning to achieve the goal. So then you have to build in the system for learning as you go. And that's what the stock takes and the reviews and the debates that I show you, that's what they're for learning. They're not for yelling at people as achievements or something like that Tony Blair never did. So it's a place where you learn how to solve these problems. So keeping with it, being ambitious, learning as you go. And actually, if you look at any other walk of life, science, sport, whatever, you'll find that the people are setting ambitious goals. By definition, they don't know how to achieve everything, otherwise they wouldn't be ambitious. But they have a system for getting data to learn.
And sort of following on from that, do you think the SDGs as they stand are achievable? I think it's clear that they are ambitious. I think that's undeniable. But sort of, do you still think, you know, a third of the way in, that they are achievable?
When I was doing the delivery, you know, we had some waiting time goals in health were difficult, but some of the crime goals were heroic. Getting the trains to run on time, you seem to be right. And so when I got that question, I'd say, yes, they're achievable. Mm-hmm. We're going to achieve them. Because somebody has to believe. Because if you take the beliefs out, then everybody stops. So my answer to that is yes. But they're really difficult. And the clock is ticking. So each one of them is achievable. To achieve all 17 would be fantastically, an extraordinary achievement for the global community. But we should work on the basis that they're achievable and really learn systematically as we go and not waste the time. One of the things that's very difficult about is people can explain them while they can think and do more research and other studies. And your days are taken away as you go. So I, my answer to that is yes, but they're really challenging.
I mean, a slight difference sort of with a UK government, which I don't know where you would put it in terms of your categorisations of governments of states and ability to have willingness and so on. It's within a well-governed framework,
yes.
And there is political will.
Yes.
Whereas actually, as you highlighted, that's not necessarily true around the world for these global goals.
No, that's right. And the most real things, as I was illustrating with the David Miliband stuff, is the way you've got fragile states or conflict. You're not going to be able to deliver the goals unless you solve those underlying problems. And so achieving just the health ones actually involves fixing government and solving conflicts before you even get into the health. So these are really difficult things to do, but we have to believe that they could be done. environmental ones or the biodiversity goals, the optimistic in me says, well, look at the changing climate public opinion on those issues right now in this country, but also in large parts of it. So there is more upward pressure on governments to do that. The pessimist in me says all the things implied in your questions, and it is really difficult. And again, one reason I'm arguing this now is we all have to understand we have to get government itself to be more effective before you can do any of these things. But there are governments with good ambitious plans. I was going to say in response to you, I overheard a conversation between a senior official and Justin Trudeau in Canada, where the senior official said, that will be impossible, Prime Minister. To which he said, that's interesting you say that, because we're going to do it. And they have done it.
Yep.
And so you have to kind of believe these hard things, and then the rest will follow. But I think there's too much complacency about the effectiveness of governments. And when governments are ineffective, people's first reaction, ordinary citizens such as ourselves, isn't, let's fix that, it's cynicism. And that just makes it all worse.
And for that particular goal, SG50, you know, effective governments are dumping their carbon waste on ineffective states.
Yeah.
So it's not attaining the goal.
Yeah. No, that coordination point is really, really important. I do see some. I mean, Britain actually. I mean, we're all quite good with the British government, but actually, Britain has quite a good track record on the climate change goals, going back to Margaret Thatcher's speech in 1989, right through to now. And one of the things that's interesting about the British election in December compared to the Canadian election in which finished in October is there's very almost no climate change denial. It didn't occur in the election at all. But in Canada it was huge, as you know.
Here and then the back and then there.
Sorry, I was just building a little bit on that. It's visited some countries and the SDGs are advertised on buses, they're all around. It's a big thing from several governments. Some governments have set
people
up.
People wear it on their lapels.
Which countries have you seen it on? Well, that's great.
Jamaica. I'm trying to think of those couple.
Yeah.
We've taken a couple. I should put my hand up and say I'm from the Office of National Statistics and read some of the SDG work. I was on the expert group on the indicators. But basically, some of the setting of the goals, targets, and indicators, we said we didn't have the data on day one, and we still haven't got it. The ambition of so many countries, they've set up separate almost departments to actually take this forward, but I don't see it in the UK. It just seems to be below the ambition. It's the leadership. Where is the leadership and the coordination?
In Britain.
Yeah,
we're waiting to see that, won't we, after the election. But I do think that you raise a really important point, which is, Where the data isn't there, so many people argue against doing it because they say it'll be bureaucratic. But actually, that is the first task. I mean, we didn't take long to get those 900 guys on motorbikes. I'm not saying it's a perfect data collection system, but it's a data collection system.
If I say the discussions we had at the time was, we didn't want to have indicators because we already had data for it. We wanted the data that we needed.
Yeah.
To actually monitor the goals.
So that just raises, you know, it reinforces the anxiety that you might not need them, but we really need to get good data or data. And that's fine. it's a huge challenge. And we got, once you start collecting data and it's not perfect, you can always get better at it. Whereas if you don't start at all, but there are big problems in this country actually, where professional groups argue against collecting data because they know it'll be used for accounting purposes. And that is fatal, ultimately. It means nothing gets done. So it's a really big issue. And actually, in the modern world, it's not that hard to collect data. If you can have a photograph of every vaccinated child in Punjab, it's really not that difficult. And by the way, my friend who set up that system, Quentin Whelan, is now doing it in the Democratic Republic of Congo. You can do it there, you can do it anywhere. And it's working, you can see the data improve. So these are achievements. achievable things, but not if you take an ideological position against the data, or if you take a very purist position, the data's got to be perfect, which is also perfect.
Okay, right to the back, yeah.
Speaking from an NGO perspective, first of all, I'm in awe of anybody who can get a government to mobilise 900 ex-servicemen on motorbikes with tablets. I think that's absolutely brilliant.
It wasn't my idea, I
isn't.
Just claim the credit. Claim the credit.
An achiever on scale has now set the bar rather high.
Yeah.
We often feel, I think, there's not just a lack of political will, but a lack of political imagination. You see, it's a case of what you could achieve. We speak to the government and say what you can achieve if you do this, and then we don't actually have that discussion that they're now seeing in the environment is what's going to happen if you don't do it. And I wonder how that push-pull thing works with you. I mean, was that something you would go down or just say no, just go for the ambition, rather than the implied threat of, oh, hey, you want an uneducated workforce or civilian population and be swayed by harmful doctrines, then fine, you go right way back.
Yeah, which NGO are you from? Which NGO?
International Network for Cancer Treatment Research.
Okay.
We're a non-state actor officially recognised by WHO.
Right, thank you. I'm not against using that. And actually, quite a lot of, if you talk to education ministers in Africa, they completely get it. Like the average Ugandan is a 14-year-old girl. So they add a million, it's about 35 million people in Uganda. They add a million people to the population every year. And the average British person is like 41 years old, 42. But Ethiopia is not far different from Uganda, and so on. Nigeria's got this floating population, and those ministers completely get that if the huge generation grows up, they won't get some massive economic benefit from having a population. They'll get instability, as you've seen around the Arab world over the last 10 years. So they do understand that, but they don't. They haven't got the capacity in place to tackle it effectively too often. I've just written something for another purpose, which I won't go to now, but on your point, I was looking ahead 15 years, and I really want to be